Good morning, everybody. Welcome to St. Mary's. I hope you are well this morning. And Merry Christmas if I haven't seen you already. You can say Merry Christmas back if you want. That's really good. I do hope that you're having a good Christmas. Today's service is communion. And again, just to reiterate our restrictions under COVID, you will be ushered again from your pews to come forward. It's just the bread you will be receiving, and we ask you to take the bread, but then move to one side or back to your pew before you consume. So please keep your face coverings on during communion. But apart from that, we'll have a good time, I hope. Today's reading, gospel reading, is based on Mary and Joseph taking the baby Jesus to the temple. 8 days old, thinking about that meeting with Simeon and with Anna. And our opening prayer preparation reminds us of that. As Mary and Joseph went on the pilgrimage of faith to Jerusalem, so we too have come on a pilgrimage of faith today to this place of worship. Meet us, O God, as we gather, and open our eyes to see the eternal truths all around us, calling us into love and more love, and things that are everlasting. Amen. We're going to have our first carol. Please remain seated, and we're going to have What Child Is This? We come to a time of confession to bring to God the things that are on our hearts and minds that we need to seek forgiveness for. Let's have a moment's quiet just to gather our thoughts. The The heavens and seas proclaim your glory, but we have polluted the skies and clogged the seas. Young and old together show the beauty of God, but we have made idols of youth and made age seem shameful. Forgive us, God, for our sins against the earth and our sins against each other. We move through age and eons in the one direction towards your love. Forgive us, God, for making idols of the things that change and ignoring what does not change in your great love. Amen. God of Trinity, eternal unity of perfect love, gather the nations to be one family and draw us into your holy life through the birth of Emmanuel, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And as an absolution, may the Lord God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You might have noticed I've just read the collect for today and prayed that too. We're going to have our readings. And our first reading is from the book of Isaiah, and Di is going to read that for us.
Readings taken from Isaiah chapter 61, beginning at verse 10 and going on to chapter 62, verse 3. Jerusalem rejoices because of what the Lord has done. She is like a bride dressed for her wedding. God has clothed her with salvation and victory. As surely as seeds sprout and grow, the sovereign Lord will save his people, and all the nations will praise him. I will speak out to encourage Jerusalem. I will not be silent until she is saved and her victory shines like a torch in the night. Jerusalem, the nations will see you victorious. All their kings will see your glory. You will be called by a new name, a name given by the Lord himself. You will be like a beautiful crown for the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We're going to have a carol again. It's Away in a Manger. It's the rendition done by the Mersey Wave Choir. And I know we've seen it a few times over Christmas, but I think it's just a lovely version. So we're going to have Away in a Manger.
Thank you.
Can I ask you please to stand for the gospel reading? Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus is presented in the temple. The time came for Joseph and Mary to perform the ceremony of purification, as the law of Moses commanded. So they took the child to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be dedicated to the Lord. They also went to offer a sacrifice of a pair of doves or two young pigeons, as required by the law of the Lord. At that time, there was a man named Simeon living in Jerusalem. He was a good, God-fearing man and was waiting for Israel to be saved. The Holy Spirit was with him, and he had assured him that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's promised Messiah. Led by the Spirit, Simeon went into the temple. When the parents brought the child Jesus into the temple to do for him what the law required, Simeon took the child in his arms and gave thanks to God. Now, Lord, you have kept your promise, and you may let your servant go in peace. With my own eyes, I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples. A light to reveal your will to the Gentiles and bring glory to your people Israel. The child's father and mother were amazed at the things Simeon said about him. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "The child is chosen by God for the destruction and the salvation of many in Israel. He will be a sign from God, which many people will speak against and so reveal their secret thoughts. And sorrow, like a sharp sword, will break your own heart." There was a very old prophet, a widow named Anna, daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She had been married for only 7 years and was now 84 years old. She never left the temple. Day and night she worshipped God, fasting and praying. That very same hour she arrived and gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were waiting for God to set Jerusalem free. When Joseph and Mary had finished all that was required by the law of the Lord, they returned to their hometown of Nazareth in Galilee. The child grew and became strong. He was full of wisdom, and God's blessings were upon him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. One of the people who's had a huge impact on my journey of faith is an Australian pastor, speaker, and a biker, and his name was John Smith. And quite an ordinary name, though, isn't it, John Smith? I used to see him for a while. We used to go to a festival called Greenbelt, and this is a Christian arts and music festival that would take place normally over the August bank holiday. And in the late 80s, early 90s, when I was younger, some of us would go and we'd camp, and it was one of those festival type things, but it was all with a Christian theme. And one of the spectacular things always was we'd have communion on the Sunday, and there may be 15 to 20,000 people having communion. I always imagined just a few bread and some fish, but it never happened that way. But John Smith was a regular there, and he would often talk, he'd give seminars, he'd preach, and he was a very challenging man. I say was, sadly passed away a couple of years ago. I think it was last year, actually. But he was always passionate about Indigenous peoples. He was very much fighting for the rights of Aboriginal people in Australia, his home country. But all over the world, he would always try and support the cause of Indigenous peoples, because he was always concerned that people would always be pushed to the margins, and the people in the situation of the Aboriginals, or maybe the American Indians in America, would always be put to the bottom of the pile. And he was always fighting their corners. And I always remember one story he told at Greenbelt. He visited, he was going around the Red Indian tribes of America, and he told about a time where he was with one of these tribes, and he sat with the tribe, and he watched as they joined in a ritual dance around a fire. And what struck him was that the whole tribe was taking part. The old and the young, the parents, the children, the grandparents, all dancing the same dance, all singing the same song. And for John, it was a beautiful scene. I remember when he was telling it, he had tears in his eyes. Why? Because he really felt that that was something our society has lost, that sense of doing everything together. One of the consequences, he would often say, of our materialistic society, our capitalist society, would say that we compartmentalize everybody. We sort of put people in groups depending on their age or their gender. And so you have young people here and the middle-aged there and the elderly there. And we quite comfortably, easily go into that. And sometimes it's necessary. And especially this time during COVID, when we're looking at vaccines, and again, we're being categorized as to who we are and our status, etc., in terms of age and underlying conditions. But John would often say that this was also a consequence in society in general. And we tend to want to put people in their boxes and have children over there, elderly over there, other people somewhere in the middle. And yet he would say, as he sat watching this tribe, there was an image of how we would love things to be more often. Everybody together, singing the same dance, dancing the same dance, singing the same song. Of course, some people might see that as old-fashioned, especially in our modern society. And so much of what we experience in our Western world actually supports this idea of categorizing, but it also highlights a tension. Because at the same time where we want to put people in places, we also have that need to want to be together. And again, COVID has shown that, hasn't it? The times where we've missed this, haven't we? We've missed being together in church, or being together with family, or being together in other community meetings. And one thing maybe that COVID has highlighted is actually deep in our hearts is this need to be together, to cut across those generational barriers and actually just spend time with each other. But so much in our Western world speaks against that and wants to support this other idea of compartmentalizing. I remember there was a sketch once I saw on the Fast Show, showed a young person, and he was being interviewed, and on his neck he had a tattoo. It had the word individual on it, and the interviewer said to him, he said, "Well, what is that?" He said, "Well, it's a tattoo, isn't it?" "Right, and what does it say?" "Well, it says individual." He said, "So why have you had that done?" He said, "Well, it's what I am, isn't it?" And all my mates have got it as well. The sense of wanting to be apart, but needing to be together. And I think that's one of the things we live in, that tension. And so much of our society would tell us that we need to be in our own age groups, in our own interest groups, in our own different social groups. But at the same time, as I said, there's a part of us that say, no, we need to be together. We need to cross those boundaries and come together. We live in a world of mixed messages. And imagine that, like me, part of you wants to feel something of that sense of community, that togetherness more in our lives. And our gospel reading gives us this wonderful image. 2,000 or more years ago, 8 days after the birth of Jesus, and Luke gives us an account of the very first all-age service. See, we think we're modern. It was happening all those years ago. And there they are in the temple, this young couple, Mary and Joseph, probably quite young. They have a baby boy who they name Jesus, whose name means the one who will save. They've come to consecrate him before God, as is the tradition of the Jewish religion. They've come to make a sacrifice. And into the scene come two elderly people, Simeon and Anna. The fact that these two are named actually shows how important this story is. So many people go unnamed in the Bible. They're just people or bystanders or the crowd. And whenever anybody's named, take note of that, because that's for a special reason. Simeon and Anna are just in a few verses in the whole of the New Testament. And yet so many people know of them because they are named. Simeon, we're told, has been promised through God's Spirit that he wouldn't die before he'd seen God's salvation or seen God's Messiah. And we're not quite sure how old he is, but we can imagine he's old. And we can imagine, I suppose, though, in those days, old, maybe not as old as we think. But he's past maybe the normal age for people to last in those days. And I imagine each day he's been looking for this promise. I imagine there are some days where he's thinking, is it ever going to happen? Was I imagining it? Did God really speak to me? You know what it's like yourself sometimes, maybe when you pray and things don't seem to happen, or maybe God doesn't seem to be listening, or you're sure something is going to happen, but it's not. Is God there? Did it really happen? And I bet there were some days where Simeon was feeling like that, because he's human like the rest of us. But this day, maybe he's got a prompting from the Holy Spirit saying, just go today. And so he goes. And he meets this couple, he sees this child, and suddenly he starts saying words of praise and worship. We know it now as the Nunc Dimittis. Let your servant go in peace, because I've seen your salvation. And Simeon could see in this child maybe what the others, and especially maybe Mary and Joseph, couldn't see. He could see salvation. He could see a light for all people, hope for the world. And I wonder what Mary and Joseph made of that. I'm always fascinated in society nowadays where we keep ourselves to ourselves quite often. And for somebody to come and speak to somebody in public, it's quite off-putting for some families. And it seems, in parts of our society, that's a taboo now. You don't speak to strangers. But here is Simeon. And maybe it's a very different society in those days. Maybe people are much more open to those sorts of conversations and people speaking and praying with each other. We do that in church, which is great, and I love it. But we don't do it as much in the wider society. I wonder what Mary and Joseph were thinking. But before they can even begin to think about that, Anna appears. She too is old, and she's very old. We're told that she's in her 80s, and that was very much unheard of in the time of Jesus. She'd been a widow for many, many years. And every day she's in the temple, maybe even lives in the temple grounds, worshipping. And again, it's to this elderly lady that wisdom and understanding are given. She speaks of redemption, the redemption that this child will bring. This child, Jesus, brings together the things that are so often separate: age, gender, status. And he really is a symbol for hope, especially in a fractured society like ours is. Jesus, again, crosses all those boundaries. What I love about church is that it doesn't matter who we are, how old we are, what we do for a living, our status, we are all one in God's sight. We meet together as one. And church should always be like that. And if ever a church is not like that, then we always need to do something about it. Church should be the place where those things are secondary, And what's more important is that we meet in the presence of God, who knows us, who loves us, and because of his Son, actually can live in our hearts and help us to live for him in the world. Jesus gives us a glimpse, maybe, in these stories of how much we really do need each other, especially in these days of COVID and pandemic. And so there's a challenge for us, I believe, in our society to try less to compartmentalize and encourage more to come together. The old teaches how to have patience. They teach us what faith is about. Just think about it for a moment. Simeon had waited so long for God to fulfill that promise. But ultimately, he never gave up hope. Our society, sadly, is one of those societies where if we don't like something, we can throw it away and get something else. We don't wait too much for things anymore. So I was having a conversation the other day about sermons. And there's a huge debate of how long a sermon should be. How long do you think a sermon should be? Anybody for an hour? 45 minutes? Half an hour? I'm not going until you've told me. But there was a discussion about how long a sermon should be. And I remember when I was training at theological college, we used to spend a lot of time watching stand-up comedians deliver the jokes and their sets as a good way of communicating. And we used to try and emulate them, as you can tell by the jokes that I give. That wasn't a joke. I don't know why you're laughing now. But the point was made, whenever you watch television now, a scene doesn't last for more than 7 seconds before it changes. And you're watching something and then there's a shift, there's a change of an angle, a change of a face. And we're so used now to watching things change straight away that actually long sermons are very much not part and parcel of people's everyday lives. Where else will people sit for, well, it's going to be 40 minutes, and just sit and watch one person speak? We don't do that very much in society now. Or in school, thanks, yes. Yes, and people said we don't heckle anymore in sermons. I said no heckling. But yeah, but it's not as common. And so we're not used to spending as much time maybe listening either before our minds are wandering onto something else. If you're a fan now of these Netflix and Amazon Prime and stuff, we're just shooting through films all the time and never really watch. And one thing I don't know if you've noticed, but whenever we're watching films now at home, we've got our phones out and we're sort of doing this while we're watching a film. Our attentions are not as focused as they used to be. And I think people of an older generation, and I'm not trying to judge people, are much more inclined to have that patience, have that time to give, much more than younger people, because they're not so much used to that. And I do think that's one thing younger people can learn from older people. Maybe a way of having that patience, having that faith. The amount of times I've taken funerals and visited families, especially from older people, and I've been told that they would always have a Bible beside their bed, and they would always say their prayers every night, and they never gave up or stopped praying for those they loved, never stopped reading. And again, maybe something that is more of a challenge to younger people nowadays. But actually, the young have a lot to teach the old as well. I remember one of my favorite books is a book called Through a Glass Darkly. It's by a Norwegian philosopher called Jostein Gaarder. You ever heard of Jostein Gaarder? He wrote a book called Sophie's World, which was a classic if you're studying philosophy. But this story called Through a Glass Darkly tells a story of a young girl who's sadly dying of leukemia. And she's in her bedroom, and every night she's visited by an angel, and they have this conversation. And the child is asking this angel all sorts of questions, and the angel's answering. And one question the young girl asked the angel, what's it like to be an angel? And the angel gives this answer. The angel said to the young girl, being an angel is a bit like being a child. Whenever an angel sees something, It has that childlike wonder of seeing something for the first time. But for an angel, it's like seeing it for the first time every time. Always that wonder, always that amazement. And that's what children have. When they see something for the first time, their eyes go wide with wonder, don't they? And they just love it. Even something as simple and straightforward, children's eyes go wide and they look with wonder, as if it's the most amazing thing they've ever seen. And sadly, as we get older, we lose that sense of wonder because we've seen it all before and it doesn't have that impact. But if we could try sometimes to see the world through a child's eyes, we can recapture some of that wonder, some of that amazement of the beauty around us. And children can teach us that, and young people can. And children also have this sense of trust as well. One thing I've noticed, if you ever put your hand out to a very young child, instantly they'll put their hand up to take it. It's almost instinct, they trust. And again, we lose that as we get older, sometimes for good reason, sadly. But there's so much that the young can teach the old. Because as we get older, as I say, we lose that sense of wonder. We lose that sense of amazement of the world that God has given us. And these are the things I think that we should look for as we come together in our all ages. And just like those 2,000 or more years ago in the temple, these generations come together. And it reminds me of a God who is for all people, for all time, in all places. And always when we meet, as a church, as a congregation, as all ages, we should always keep in mind each other. Always look to learn from each other. Because Jesus is the Savior of everybody. And nobody is excluded, young or old, whatever gender status. We are all loved and we are all cared for. And Jesus died for all of us. I love it when we're in church and the old and the younger there, men and boys and women and girls, all here, all different. But Jesus can and does speak to each and every one of us. And that's the wonderful power of Jesus. And that is why he came. He came to bring people back to each other and back to God. And we need that so much in our world, especially in our Western world, I believe, this day. Our world, sadly, is a place where countries are divided, communities are divided, families are divided. In Jesus, we find that we are all equal. There are no differences. And it doesn't matter about where we live, the color of our skin, the language we speak, even if we support Everton. Sorry. God loves us so much that he sent his only son so that all could know him and, like today, share this experience together. Just like Mary and Joseph and Simeon and Anna, God has shown us who this baby is, and we need to welcome him too. We need to put aside any prejudices that we have. We need to learn again how to trust and how to be patient as we share Jesus' story with others. And like those in the temple that day, we need to constantly praise God for Jesus. Let me just say a prayer. Lord God, I thank you that you love us as we are. We thank you that you see us as we are and that you welcome us, whoever we are. Help us always to try to see this world through your eyes. Help us always to try to love each other the way you love us. And help us always to seek to break down the unnecessary barriers that so often we put up. And I pray all this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. We're going to now say the words of the Creed. Can I ask you please to stand? So let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And together we say, though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Please will you sit for our time of prayer. The response to the prayers comes up on the screen in the red fonts. Today we honour Simeon and Anna, old both. They had the light that sustained them. They had held strongly to what they knew they hoped for. May we, people of all ages, be held together by what sustains us, whether 7 or 70. May we know what is most important. God, in your mercy, hear us. Today we honour all shapes of families. Families by choice, families by adoption, families by birth, families in grief, families in multiple homes, families in negotiation, families in care, families in support. In all shapes of family, may we find words of love and kindness. And just before we have that final response, let's just have a moment to hold our own families in our prayers. Our own loved ones, maybe those who are nearby, maybe those who are far away. And let's ask God's blessing to be upon them. God, in your mercy, hear us. Today we pray for people who are ignored because of their age. In an era where youth and beauty are praised, we have so often ignored wisdom, experience, long-standing faithfulness, and perspective. For all who have felt overlooked, and for all who have love and wisdom to share, we pray. God, in your mercy, hear us. We do pray today for those who are suffering in body, in mind, or in spirit. And let's bring in our thoughts and our prayers, those known to us who need to know healing and wholeness in their lives this day. Lord, through your Holy Spirit, you brought transformation to so many lives. Through your Son, you were able to bring healing and wholeness. We pray for those in our thoughts and our prayers today. God, in your mercy, hear us. And we pray today for those who are bereaved, those for whom Christmas will be a painful time because of grief and sorrow, because they have lost someone they have loved. And again, let's bring to mind those known to us and those known to God. We thank you, Lord God, that through your Son, Jesus Christ, we can now know that death is not the end, that we can live this life with hope, that there is a warmth and a welcome beyond the horizon that is death. We thank you for your Son, and we pray that those who grieve will know these promises in their hearts. God, in your mercy, hear us. And together, if you're able to, we pray the Lord's Prayer during communion. So let's just say, Amen. Amen. We're going to share the peace. Let's stand together to share the peace. As the prophet Isaiah said, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called the Prince of Peace." May the peace of the Lord be always with you. And please, let's show each other a sign of peace. Please will you be seated. We're going to move into our communion. And before that, we're going to play another song. It's called Mary, Did You Know? I played a song over the Christmas time called, it was called Mary's Song, Breath of Heaven. And some people thought it was quite a powerful song. I was trying to focus on actually the struggles that Mary might have had during those times. And this is another song which again highlights some of the thoughts maybe of Mary as she saw her child grow. So Mary, did you know? We're going to follow Eucharistic Prayer E, and I'm going to use the seasonal provisions. So just on the screen, you're going to see the responses as opposed to the whole of the Eucharistic Prayer. So let us pray. The Lord is here. Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. All glory and honor be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who for love of our fallen race humbled himself, was born of the Virgin Mary by the power of your Spirit, and lived as one of us. In this mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused this light to shine in our hearts, to give knowledge of your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. In him we see our God made visible, and so are caught up in the love of the God we cannot see. Therefore, with all the angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name and sing our joyful hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey your command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your Son, or your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends. And taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favor on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven, through Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Amen. And as our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Thank you. Christ keep you in eternal life. May the body of Christ keep you in eternal life. David, the body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Will the body of Christ keep you in eternal life? Ruth, the body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son shared at Nazareth the life of an earthly home, help your church to live as one family, united in love and obedience, and bring us at last to our home in heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our final carol is See Amid the Winter Snow. We remain seated. comes the end of our service, and just before we have our final blessing, just a notice to give. So, for a start, people have asked about the Christingle. Sadly, again, because of restrictions, we're not going to be able to have the Christingle as you would normally have with the church full. So we're going to be having an online Christingle. We're going to hopefully involve the schools as well and asking the children there to make their own Christingles. But also, we've got the wherewithal for the children within the church community also to make their own Christingles. There'll be more of that over the next coming week or so. Hopefully as well, come from next week, we're going to try and get back to a bit more normality. Just a bit. Our rota will be going back up again for readers and intercessors, so do look out for that. And I haven't spoken to David yet, so I'll just say that. Hopefully we'll have some more piano music, and I'll speak to David more about that in a time. So don't shake your head just yet. Wait till we've had the conversation. So there are the notes I would love to put out at this moment. Any other notices I need to give? Ah, Jilly's showing me, yes. So on the table as you go out, there are some little chocolate bars. Christmas Day, the message I wanted to give out was the gift that God was giving through his son. And as a very, very pale reflection of that, I was giving a gift of a chocolate bar. But we all need chocolate, don't we? We do. And there was some left over from that service, so if you're inclined to do so, please do take a chocolate bar with you as you leave. Please wait until you're ushered as well. To leave, we're going out through the main entrance, and therefore we do need people to remain seated until they're asked to get out. To leave. And is there any good news to celebrate? Mavis, I'm going to come down to you so you don't have to shout. What's your good news, Mavis? Yes.
The baby boy on Christmas Eve.
Oh, your next neighbour, Rachel, the baby boy? Yes. Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve. Do you know the name?
No.
No, but everybody okay?
As far as I know, yes.
Oh, that's wonderful news. Wonderful news. That poor child at Christmas time and birthdays, you know, it's... What do you do? Joe?
My birthday
is your birthday Christmas Eve?
It's a wonderful time to have.
So we can sing happy birthday to you now. It's a great time to have a birthday. So tell your neighbour that, Rachel. Any other good news to celebrate? Colin, what's your good news?
Everton.
What?
They
play football, don't they? That's right, yes. Second in the league, as somebody will point out in a moment. It's a good time to be a football fan, isn't it? It really is. Any birthdays to celebrate apart from Joe? Normally I ask how old they are, but I'm not going to go down that one. How old?
71.
Only 71?
Yes.
Really? Okay. So we're going to sing happy birthday to Joe. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Joe, happy birthday to you. Congratulations. I do wish you a great day, and I hope that you're able to be in contact with family and friends. I hope so. We're going to finish with a prayer of blessing. May the imagination of the shepherds, the persistence of the wise men, the transforming acceptance of Joseph, and the compassion of Mary for her child and for all the oppressed be in our minds and actions now and always. Amen. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and all whom you love now and always. Amen. So do go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. Yeah.